Welcome back, everyone. We are a little bit over time now, which is not a major problem, as the next talk did not show up. We're sorry for that. So we directly go to the second talk of this session, and that is by Maitana Grande, also from Spain, a little bit further to the east, but northern Spain as well. And she'll be talking about the reproductive strategy and capacity of the skipjack in the Western Indian Ocean. The floor is yours. Thanks for coming.
Okay, thank you. So good morning to all. My name is Maitane Grande, and I'm doing the PhD in ASTI. I'm studying the ecology of the skipjack, and today I'm going to present a part of the work. So I'm going to talk about the reproductive strategy and capacity of the skipjack in the Western Indian Ocean. The skipjack is a scum breed widely distributed in the tropical and subtropical waters worldwide. Is an heteroparous and gonochoristic fish, and previous studies has defined it as opportunistic batch spawner. The spawning occurs in offshore waters whenever the hydrological conditions are favorable. In terms of the fishery, is an important species because 35% of the catches, of total tuna catches worldwide, are of skipjack, and a big part of them are fish in the Western Indian Ocean. This species is not prone to overfishing, but the catches has decreased in the last decades. Also, the biological information available is scarce and not updated. So we thought that there is a need of this information. So in order to study the reproductive biology of the skipjack, we define three objectives. Firstly, we wanted to define the reproductive strategy in terms of ovarian organization and fecundity type. For that, we based in previous works. We analyzed the ovary at oocyte level, and we studied the oocyte size frequency distribution, the seasonal variation in the percentage of the oocyte classes, and the seasonal variation on the diameter of the oocyte. Then, going to individual and population level, we estimated the size at first maturity and the batch fecundity and the relative batch fecundity. And finally, we saw its relationship with the area, season, for length and condition indices. So our study is based in the Western Indian Ocean. This area is dominated by monsoon regimes, and it can be divided in three seasons depending on the wind traits: winter monsoon season, summer monsoon season, and inter monsoon season. Our sampling was carried out upon the fishing vessels from January 2009 to April 2010. At the beginning, we wanted to cover all the trimesters in 2009, but because the piracy problem, we couldn't. So we completed the work in 2010. Overall, we fished more than 1,200 fish, and more than the 50% were females. We collected females' ovaries, and we take other measures, such as the fore length, gonad weight, total weight, and others. We analyzed the gonad in the laboratory by histologically to classify each female in its reproductive state. Then, to some of them, we applied the image analysis to assess the oocyte diameter distribution. And finally, to the female in the more mature state, we applied the gravimetric method to estimate the batch fecundity. From the histological slide, we analyzed the oocyte development, and we divided it in 8 stages, as previous study did. We did not found oocytes in hydrated states. We defined the oocyte development as asynchronous, because all type of oocytes could be present in the ovary, without a dominant population present. We will use this classification to classify each female in each reproductive state based in the more developed oocyte in the ovary. So we classify the females as mature from cortical alveoli on. And also we saw the incidence of atresia to classify females in inactive states. From the image analysis data, we describe the oocyte diameter distribution from cortical alveoli, bit 1, bit 2, bit 3, and migration stages. We saw that it was continuous with no gap between previtelogenic and vitelogenic. That means that it could be a recruitment from previtelogenic to vitelogenic during the spawning season. That could be an evidence of indeterminate fecundity. We saw that the spawning occurred in batches and that the batch start to form in bit 2 states. And is more pronounced in bit 3 and is almost totally separated in migration stages. To study the seasonal variation in the percentage of oocyte by state, we choose those females in bit 3 states. We took the ovaries and we classify all the oocytes from cortical alveoli to bit 3 states. We saw that the frequency distribution of oocytes in different stages was constant during the sampling period. Then we estimated the mean diameter of the oocytes, and we saw that there were not differences among months, and that it was a decrease in the mean diameter also of oocytes from cortical alveoli to bit 3 during 2009. That means that it could be a replenishment of small oocytes during this season. That is an evidence of indeterminate fecundity. Also, we selected those oocytes in bit 3 states and we did the same. We saw that there were not statistically significant differences among months and that the diameter tend to stay constant during 2009. So that means also that it could be a replenishment of smaller oocytes into this group. Going to individual and population level, we classify all the females in each one of the reproductive stages. We saw that almost there were not immature females and almost all of them were in vitellogenic stage. No fish was found in hydrated stage. To estimate the length at first maturity, we applied a logistic regression, and when doing it to the pool data, we estimate a length at first maturity of 40 centimeters. And when doing it by area, we saw differences in the length at first maturity, getting lower values for Seychelles and bigger for Mozambique Channel. Studying the seasonal variation in the occurrence of various reproductive stages, we saw that the reproductive activity was very high during all the sampling period because more than the 70% of females were reproductively active from cortical alveoli to migration stage. We saw that there were peaks in the activity because in 2009, January and July, ay, mierda. In 2009, in January and July, almost all the females were reproductively active. Although in February and March, these values were high also, the number of females in inactive stage was higher. So that could imply that these months were related with the end of the reproductive high activity season. In April and May, the reproductive activity was the lowest because the number of females reproductively active was lowest. Also, we analyzed the incidence of atresia. For that, we classify all the females in each atretic state, as you see in the table, and we saw that there is a seasonal variation. In January, the values were low and then increased in February and March to go down again in June and July. February and March could be related with the end of the high reproductive activity season. In April and May, we obtained intermediate values. Going to the seasonal variation in the condition indices, we saw that the GSI value was over 1.5 during 2009. This is related with the bit 1 state, so a big proportion of females at the population level were active during 2009. We maximum values on GSI, that is represented with the red line, were obtained in January and February, and minimums in March, June, to go up again in July. The hepatosomatic index showed the same trend as gonadosomatic index, and this could be explained because the energy accumulation in the liver and the mobilization to the gonad is a rapid mechanism which could occur in synchrony. And thus, the oocyte development could be dependent on the food intake during the spawning season and not before. On the other hand, in the next figure, we saw that there is an asynchrony in the spawning because different length classes show different peaks in the GSI value. So to finish, I will explain the batch fecundity results. We saw in the upper graph and in the batch fecundity and in the bottom relative batch fecundity. Both of them were highly variable among the same length classes, and we think that it could be dependent on hepatosomatic index or condition of the fish that could be dependent of individual seasonality. So to conclude, we have to say that the ovarian development organization is asynchronous and its fecundity indeterminate, because the oocytes of all states were present in the ovary with no dominant population present, the oocyte distribution is continuous with no gap between pre-vitellogenic and vitellogenic, the frequency distribution of oocytes is similar among all months, and the mean diameter of the oocytes from cortical alveoli to B3 and the mean diameter of advanced vitellogenic oocyte was not different among months. In the first case, it showed a decreasing trend during 2009. In the second case, it was maintained constant. On the other hand, the size at first maturity was estimated in 40 centimeters, which could vary spatially. The skipjack spawn all year round, with increasing peaks in the activity that could be related with the monsoon event. We saw a synchrony in the spawning at the population level because different peaks in the reproductive activity were observed by size classes. And the batch fecundity was highly variable among the same size classes, which could be dependent of HSI. So this work will be completed in the future with the estimation of the approximate composition in gonad, liver and muscle, and it will be assessed its variation during the spawning season. Also, we will try to describe the feeding ecology of the individuals and see its relationship with the condition. And finally, we will try to investigate whether the skipjack has a specific nursery areas or not, based in the microchemistry of the nucleus of the otoliths. So thank you.